of the same month, then someone can figure out what your key is. The story is pretty similar, but the details are a little different. So yeah, so even if you actually generate your key somewhere else, your key was green. It's just that every time you generate a signature, you would, and you generated two signatures with exactly the same month or random value, someone could apply some clever math to your signatures and sort of extract your public key out of it, or private key, more importantly. Alright, other questions, lunch? Any comments? Is that all the time? Alright, so, I guess one thing I wanted to point out is that actually, well, as you're starting to appreciate, is that in computer security, almost every detail has a chance of really mattering. Like, if you screw up almost something seemingly inconsequential, like forgetting to check something, or this, or forgetting to initialize a random key, it can have pretty dramatic consequences for the overall system. You really have to be very clear about what is the specification of your system, what is it doing, essentially what are all the corner cases. It's a way to sort of think of breaking a system, or conversely, figuring out if your system is secure. It's really crucial to edge case. Like, what happens if my input is just large enough, or what is the biggest or the smallest input, what is the strangest set of inputs I can provide to my program and push it in all these corner cases. You know, one example of this ambiguity, sort of a good example to keep in mind, is how SSL certificates, again, encode names into the certificate itself. So this is a different problem than the problem about the certificate already being trusted. So these SSL certificates are just, you know, sequences of bytes that a web server sends to you. And inside of this SSL certificate is the name of the server you're connecting to, so something like Amazon.com. So you can just put down those bytes, you can encode it somehow, and specify, well, it's Amazon.com, and that's the end of the string. So in SSL certificates, they use a particular encoding scheme that writes down Amazon.com, but by first writing down the number of bytes in the string. So you first write down, okay, well, I'm going to have a 10-byte string called Amazon.com. In the SSL certificate, somewhere in there, there's this byte 10, followed by 10 bytes, saying what the hostname is. And there's other stuff afterwards, right? And when a browser takes it, well, you know, the browser is written in C, and the way C represents strings is by null truncating them. So in C, a string doesn't have a length count. Instead, it has all the bytes, and the end of the string is just a byte 0. And in C, you sort of write it with a backslash 0. Sure, sure. So in memory, in your browser, somewhere in memory, there's this string of 11 bytes now with an extra 0 at the end. And when a browser interprets the string, it just keeps going until it sees an end of string marker, which is a 0 byte. Okay, so what can go wrong? Can you get this?
Yeah,
this is great, right? So this is actually like a bit of a discontinuity in terms of how this guy represents strings and this guy. So suppose that I own the domain foo.com, so I can get certificates for anything.foo.com. So what I could do is ask for a certificate for the name, you know, amazon.com0x.foo.com. That's a perfectly valid string. It has, you know, a bunch of bytes. Like, it's 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, the number 4, 20, right? So it's a 20-byte name of with these 20 bytes. So it used to be that if you go to a certificate authority, in any case, you can say, hey, you know, I own foo.com, give me a certificate for this thing, and they'd be perfectly willing to do it because it's a subdomain of foo.com. It's all yours. But then when a browser takes this string and loads it in memory, well, what it does is the same thing that's here. It copies the string, amazon.com/0x.foo.com. It'll dutifully add the terminating 0 at the end. But then, when the rest of the browser software goes and tries to interpret the string as the memory location, it'll keep going up until it gets to the zero, and say, well, it's the end of the string. So this is Amazon.com, that's it. So, this sort of disconnect between how C software and how SSL certificates represent names led to some, you know, unfortunate security problems. This was, you know, actually discovered a number of years ago now by a guy, Moxie Marlin's bike. But, you know, it's a pretty clever observation. And these kinds of encoding bugs are actually also pretty common in lots of software, because unless you're pretty diligent about exactly how you encode things, there might be different ways of encoding, and whenever there's disagreement, there's a chance that I can take advantage of this. Also, some things with a fine name and other things with not something else. So these are good places to sort of push a system to see how it might break. Does that make sense? All right, so maybe the last example of mechanism failure I'm going to talk about today, it's a reasonably popular one, is the problem of buffer overflows. So some of you have seen this in, or at least at some level, in 603B. It's an undergrad course, but for those of you that have forgotten or haven't taken OCC, we'll sort of go over buffer overflows in more detail, and this will be actually quite critical for you guys because lab one is all about buffer overflows, and you're going to be exploiting these vulnerabilities in a somewhat real web server. So let's figure out what is the setting. What are we talking about here? So the setting we're going to be considering is a system which has, let's say, a web server. So what we have is, you know, we have some computer out there that has a web server on it, and the web server is a program that is going to accept connections from the outside world, take requests, and we're going to take these packets and somehow process them and, you know, do some checking, probably if it's an illegal URL or they're trying to access a file they're not authorized to access, the web server is going to return an error. But otherwise, we're going to, you know, access some files, maybe on disk, and send them back out in some sort of a reply. So the hugely common picture, all the things that you look at, what's the policy or what's the threat model? So the bit of a problem in many real-world systems, namely that this is pretty hard to pin down what is the exact policy or threat model that we're talking about. And this looking precision or ambiguity about policies, platforms, etc., sometimes leads to security problems. Well, that's a pretty good case, but we'll see. Maybe just to give you a sense of how to think of a typical web server in the context of, you know, this policy of multiple kind of stuff, is that, well, probably the policy is the web server should do what the programmer intended to do. It's all vague, so that's probably what's going on, because anything more specific is, well, the web server should do exactly what the code does is going to be a bit of an off, and if the code has a bug, well, your policy says, well, that's exactly what I should do. I should follow the bug. So hard to say the policy precisely, but in this case, let's go with, you know, some intuitive version of, well, the web server should do what the programmer wanted it to do. And the first model is probably that the attacker doesn't have access to this machine, can't log into it remotely, doesn't have physical access to it, but can send any packet they want. So they're not restricted to certain kinds of packets. Anything they can shape and sort of deliver to the web server, that's fair game. Seems like a reasonable threat model in practice to have in mind. And I guess the goal is that this web server shouldn't allow arbitrary stuff to go wrong here. I guess it sort of goes along with what the programmer intended. The programmer probably didn't intend any request to be able to access anything on the server. And yet it turns out if you make certain kinds of mistakes in writing the web server software, which is basically the mechanism here. The web server software is the thing that takes a request and looks at it and makes sure that it's not going to do something bad, sends a response back, and everything's okay. The web server is the mechanism. It's enforcing your policy. And as a result, if the web server software is buggy, then you're in trouble. And one sort of common problem, if you're writing software in C, which, you know, many things are still written in C and probably will continue to be written in C for a while, you can mismanage your memory allocations. And as we saw in this SSL certificate gaming example, even sort of a single byte can really make a huge difference in terms of what goes on. And I guess for this example, we'll look at a small piece of code that's, you know, not quite a real web server. In the lab, you'll have this whole picture to play with. But for lecture, I just want to give you a simplified example so we can talk about what's sort of at the core of what's going wrong. And in particular, if the system wakes up, I will show you sort of a very small C function, and we can sort of see what goes wrong if you provide different inputs to that piece of code. All right, so the C function that I have in mind is this guy. Let's see. One more here, I can. Oh, yeah. Let's see. All right. So here's the sort of program I'm talking about, or I want to use as an example here. So the program is just going to read a request. And you can sort of imagine it's going to read a request from the network, but for the purposes of this example, it's going to read a request from whatever I'm typing in on the keyboard. And it's going to, you know, store it in a buffer here, and then it's going to parse it as an integer and return the integer, and the program will then print whatever integer I get back. But far from a web server, but, you know, we'll see some basics of how buffer overflows work and what goes wrong. So let's see actually what happens if you run this program. So I can compile it here, and actually you can sort of see the, it's already telling me what I'm screwing up, right? The get function is dangerous and should not be used. And we'll see in a second why the compiler is so intent on telling you this. And it actually is true. But, you know, for now, suppose we're, you know, a happy-go-lucky developer that is willing to ignore this warning. Okay, you know, I run this read-write function, I provide some input, and it, you know, works. Let's see if I provide logic. Besides, you know, if I type in some large number, well, I think it gives me some large number. It basically maxes out to 2 to the 31 and prints that and doesn't go any higher. Plus, maybe not disastrous, right? You know, whatever, you provided us, you know, ridiculously large number, you got something that didn't quite work. So, it's not quite a problem yet. But if you provide some really large inputs, we might get some other problem, right? So, sort of providing a lot of parts. Well, if I just provided things that are not numbers, you know, from zero, that's not so bad. But, sort of got paste in a huge number of these. Okay, so now the program crashes, right? You know, taking up too surprising. So, if it was the case that, you know, I send a bad request to a web server, it doesn't get back to me or doesn't send a reply, that would be fine. But we'll sort of look inside and see what happens and try to figure out how we can actually take advantage of this crash to maybe do something much more interesting or, well, much more along with that. That might be interesting doing. So this is, we're going to run this program under a debugger. You'll get super familiar with this in lab one. But now what we're going to do is set a breakpoint in that read-write function, and we're going to sort of run along and see what happens. So when I run the program, it's going to start executing the main function, and pretty quickly it calls the redirect, and the debugger is now stopped at the beginning of redirect. And we can actually see what's going on here by, you know, for example, we can ask it to print the current CPU registers. We're going to look at really low-level stuff here, as opposed to a level of C source code. We're going to look at the actual instructions that my machine is executing, because that's what really is going on. The C is actually maybe hiding something from us. So you can actually print all the registers, so on x86, as you might remember from, well, on the architecture, there's a stack pointer. So let me start maybe drawing this diagram on the board so we can try to reconstruct what's happening. So what's going on is that my program, not surprisingly, has a stack. On x86, the stack grows down, so it sort of is a stack like this, and we can keep pushing stuff onto it. So right now, the stack pointer points at this particular memory location, FFG010. So, you know, some value. So we can try to figure out how to get there. One way to do it is to disassemble the code of this read-write function. Do you know what better? Really? Convenience variable. It must have integer value. Right? Okay, another way to look at it. Well, we can disassemble the function by name. So this is what the function is doing. So first off, it starts by, you know, manipulating something with the EDT register. That's not super interesting. But the first thing it does after that is subtract a certain value from the stack pointer. This is basically making space for all those variables, like the buffer and the integer I we saw in the C source code. So we're actually now four instructions into the function here, so that stack pointer value that we saw before